Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 17th September 2019. These are the list of articles chosen for today's analysis. It has been given along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi, Thiruvananthapuram and Hyderabad editions. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping for the displayed articles is provided in the description box below. And for the benefit of smartphone users, the timestamping is also provided in the comment section. Let's move on to the first article analysis. This article is about the detention of former Jammu and Kashmir Chief Minister. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. The news article states that the Home Department of Jammu and Kashmir has issued orders to detain former Jammu and Kashmir Chief Minister Farooq Abdullah. According to the news article, he will be detained for 12 days. He has been detained under the Jammu and Kashmir Public Safety Act of 1978. Here, detention or detaining someone means keeping a person in official custody. And it is for questioning about a crime or due to a politically sensitive situation in the state or in the country. Now, in this Jammu and Kashmir scenario, it is the politically sensitive situation because recently, the Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Act was enacted, which bifurcated the state into two union territories. The news article also states that as per the latest order by Jammu and Kashmir Home Department under this Public Safety Act, his residence has been declared a subsidiary jail. Now know that subsidiary jail is used for the custody of persons who are ordered to be detained under any law. It is any place which has been declared by the state government by any general order or special order for the detention of a person. So in this case, his residence has been declared as the subsidiary jail. The news article further adds that it is expected that the period of detention could be extended for a maximum of 3 months. So now in this context, let us discuss about the Jammu and Kashmir Public Safety Act of 1978. This is a state act which was applicable to the Jammu and Kashmir state only. This act was enacted in the interest of security of the state and public order. If you see under 7th schedule of Indian Constitution, laws with respect to preventive detention for reasons connected with the security of state and maintenance of public order comes under the concurrent list. Now here, preventive detention is the imprisonment of a person with the aim of preventing them from committing any offences or imprisoning them for maintaining the public order. Now this subject comes under the concurrent list, which means the state legislature can also enact law under this subject. Now this provision is provided under Article 246 Clause 2 of Indian Constitution. This article states that the legislature of any state can also have the power to make laws with respect to any of the matters enumerated in the list 3 in the 7th schedule. And we know that list 3 is the concurrent list. So this means whatever the subjects are given under concurrent list, under these subjects, laws can be enacted both by the parliament and also by the state legislatures. But if you see, one another subject comes under union list, which is pertaining to preventive detention. It is the preventive detention for reasons connected with defense, foreign affairs or the security of India and persons who are subjected to such detention because of it. Now this subject comes under union list. This means only parliament has the power to make legislation for the subject mentioned in this list. Now this provision is provided by Article 246 Clause 1. It states that Parliament has exclusive power to make laws with respect to any of the matters enumerated in List 1 of the 7th schedule. And List 1 is the Union List. Now coming back to the Jammu and Kashmir Public Safety Act, this act contains provision for designating protected areas and prohibited areas in the state. It also has the provisions for the prevention of circulation of documents in the interest of communal harmony, etc. Now today's article discussion is based on detention of persons. So this provision comes under Section 8 of this Act. It deals with the powers of authorities to detain persons under this Act. This Act states that the government may make an order directing that a person be detained. And the government can make an order if the government is satisfied that it can detain a person with a view to preventing him from acting in any manner which is prejudicial to the security of the state or which is prejudicial to the maintenance of public order. Prejudicial means harmful. So if any person is acting harmful to the security of the state or is harmful to maintain the public order, then that person can be detained by the state government. So what are the actions which come under this particular provision? That is, what are the actions which means prejudicial to the maintenance of public order? The actions which are promoting, propagating or attempting to create the feelings of enmity or hatred or disharmony on grounds of religion, race, caste, community or region is the act which is prejudicial to the maintenance of public order. Along with this, if a person is making preparations for using a force or attempting to use a force or is instigating or inciting or abetting the use of a force which either disturbs or is likely to disturb public order is also a action which is prejudicial to the maintenance of public order. Instigating or inciting means either starting up or encouraging someone to do the action. And abetting also means encouraging someone to do action or even assisting a person to do something wrong. And the actions which attempt to commit or instigate or incite or even provoke or even abet the commission of a mischief is also an action which is prejudicial to the maintenance of public order, if it either disturbs or is likely to disturb the public order. Then also the actions which is attempting to commit or instigate or incite or provoke or abet the commission of an offense which is punishable with death or which is punishable with imprisonment for life or with punishment or which is punishable with imprisonment for a term extending to 7 years or more is deemed as an action which is prejudicial to the maintenance of public order, because the commission of such offense disturbs or is likely to disturb the public order. So these are the actions which leads to the detention of a person under this act. According to this act, the detention is ordered by the divisional commissioners or even by the district magistrates. But the news article says that this authority is also given to the Home Department of Jammu and Kashmir, and it was given by a special order. Now, when such detention order is made, the official has to report the fact to the government, and this fact should be given along with the grounds on which the order has been made. And also know that this order remains in force for only 12 days. This provision is given by Section 8, Clause 4 of this Act. It states that no such order shall remain in force for more than 12 days. And if it is to be extended, then it has to be approved by the government. That is why the former Chief Minister Farooq Abdullah has been initially detained for 12 days only. If it has to be extended, then it is to be approved by the state government of Jammu and Kashmir. Now, after this, in every case where a detention order has been made under this act, the government shall place the details about the order before a advisory board, and it has to be placed within 4 weeks from the date of detention order. And the details about the order includes the grounds on which the order has been made and the representation made by the person who is affected by the order, and also the report by the officer who made the order under subsection 4 of section 8. All these things should be placed before the advisory board. Now, this advisory board is constituted under section 14 of this act. This board consists of a chairman who is or who has been a judge of the High Court. That is, who is presently a judge of High Court or who is a former judge of High Court. And this advisory board also consists of two other members who are or who have been or who are qualified to be appointed as judges of High Court. The chairman and the other members of the board shall be appointed by the government in consultation with the Chief Justice of the High Court. Now, this advisory board has to submit its report to the government within 6 weeks from the date of detention. This report of the advisory board has to specify whether there is sufficient cause for the detention of the person or whether there is no sufficient cause for the detention of that person. So, if in any case where the advisory board has reported that there is sufficient cause for the detention of a person, then the government may confirm the detention order and the government can continue the detention of the person who is concerned for a period as the government may think as fit. Now, this doesn't mean that the government can order for detention for an unlimited time period. Now, this is because the Section 18 of the Act provides for the maximum period of detention. The maximum period for which any person may be detained if the person is acting in any manner prejudicial to the maintenance of public order is 3 months in the first instance, and this can be extended to 12 months, that is 1 year. Then if a person is acting in any manner which is prejudicial to the security of the state, then that person shall be detained for 6 months in the first instance, and it can be extended to 2 years to the maximum. So with this, we have come to the end of this news article analysis. The respect practice question will be discussed in the last session. This news article is regarding National Center for Clean Coal Research and Development. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. The Department of Science and Technology, which comes under the Ministry of Science and Technology, has launched the National Center for Clean Coal Research and Development. It has been launched at the Indian Institute of Science, that is at the IISc Bengaluru. This institute has been launched to address the opportunities and challenges in the development of clean coal technology. So, this national center will perform the research and development activities in clean coal technologies. It will act as a national consortium on clean coal research and development, which will be led by IISc Bengaluru. Here, consortium means association of different institutions. So, many institutes will collaborate with this newly set up National Center for Clean Coal Research and Development. This consortium will work on identifying existing gaps in the clean coal technology. So, before knowing about clean coal technologies, let us see about coal. Coal is the major source of energy. Coal is used in the thermal power plants to generate power. The domestically available coal is transported from the coal mines, and the imported coal is transported from the seaports to the thermal power plants. In the power plants, the coal is ground, then they are burnt. When they are burnt, steam will be generated, and this steam will run the turbines, which will generate electricity. This is the conventional combustion method of generating electricity. But there are two major problems that the Indian thermal power plants are facing using the conventional method. One is the high level of pollutants from the coal, and second is the low thermal efficiency. Here, thermal efficiency is nothing but the efficiency of the heat engine. Here, the turbine converts the heat energy to electricity. So, the thermal efficiency is measured by the ratio of the work done by the turbine to the heat supplied to it. This thermal efficiency depends on the purity of the coal that is supplied. So, if the coal is more impure, then the level of pollutants that are emitted will be high. So, we saw the conventional combustion method. There is one another method, which is called as coal gasification. This technique is said to have greater efficiency than conventional coal burning. It is because it can effectively use the gases twice. The coal gases are first cleansed to remove impurities, and then they are fired in the turbine to generate electricity. We saw that when the coal is burnt, several gases and pollutants will be emitted. These gases are sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxides, particulate matter, carbon dioxide, fly ash, and also mercury and certain other heavy metals. And the emission of these gases and pollutants will lead to air pollution. So, we can see that there are operational challenges in generating power from coal, and there are also challenges because it creates pollution. So, that is why we are moving towards clean coal technology is any technology that will make the functioning of coal power plants more efficient. Mostly, the research and development is carried out in new combustion and gasification technologies. So, this new center will also work on addressing these challenges, like the development of low emission combustion and gasification. This will be done so that high cycle efficiencies are achieved with reduced pollutants, so that we can achieve high efficiency and low emission. Hence, the ultimate aim of this national center is the development of clean coal technologies in order to reduce carbon emissions from coal-based power plants. This center was inaugurated by Union Minister of Science and Technology. He has said that this center would enable the achievement of an affordable, efficient and compact, reliable clean energy system. He also added that this center would help India in achieving the international targets on climate change. The international target which he has mentioned is the nationally determined contributions. We know the 2015 Paris Climate Agreement. This Paris Agreement requires each country which is party to the agreement to outline and communicate their post-2020 climate actions. This is known as the country's NDCs or the nationally determined contributions. This news article mentions two NDCs of India. One NDC is that by the year 2030, India plans to achieve at least 40% of the total requirement of energy from clean energy sources. With respect to this, the Union Minister has noted that India has already achieved around 34 to 35%, and this is a significant progress. The next NDC is reducing the emissions of greenhouse gases by 33% to 35% below the 2005 levels, and this has to be done by the year 2030. With respect to this, the Union Minister has noted that India has already achieved 20 to 21% reduction of emissions of greenhouse gases. So by this, the Union Minister has intended to convey that centers like these, National Center for Clean Coal Research and Development, will help us to achieve more NDC targets. He has also emphasized on the need for coordination and cooperation between institutions and individuals, those who are working in science and technology. With this, we have come to the end of this article discussion. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. This discussion is based on uranium mining. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. The news article states that the State Legislative Assembly of Telangana has passed an unanimous resolution. In this resolution, the state of Telangana has requested the central government to not to permit the mining of uranium ore, which is present in Nallamala forest and the adjoining areas in the state of Telangana. So let us see a short background about this issue. In December 2016, the Atomic Minerals Directorate for Exploration and Research got approval for an exploration proposal from the Telangana State Board of Wildlife. This Atomic Minerals Directorate for Exploration and Research comes under the Department of Atomic Energy. This approval was to explore the uranium deposits in the state, and especially in the Nallamala forest and the adjoining areas in the state. The Telangana State Board of Wildlife approved this proposal and gave permission for an exploratory survey in the 83 square kilometer of forest area in the Tiger Reserve. This Tiger Reserve is in Amrabad and Udimilla of Nagakarnool district and is in Narayanpur of Nalgonda district. It is together called as the Amrabad Tiger Reserve. Now, know that Amrabad Tiger Reserve was earlier part of the Nagarjuna Sagar Srisailam Tiger Reserve. The northern part of the Nagarjuna Sagar Srisailam Tiger Reserve came under the state of Telangana after the bifurcation of Andhra Pradesh state. So this northern part was renamed as Amrabad Tiger Reserve. Also know that the Nagakarnool district was initially known as Mehboob Nagar district. After this permission, the Uranium Corporation of India Limited did not find the minerals of desired quality in the particular area. So in February 2017, the Telangana State Board of Wildlife met for a meeting. In this meeting, it was made clear that there was no proposal to mine uranium. But again, the Atomic Minerals Directorate for Exploration and Research came up with a proposal to the Ministry of Environment, Forests and Climate Change. The proposal was to seek permission to explore the uranium over 83 square kilometer area in Amrabad Tiger Reserve. But the Forest Advisory Committee observed that there are certain deficiencies in the proposal. However, considering the fact that the proposal is of critical importance from national perspective, it recommended for in principle approval. So the Forest Advisory Committee gave in principle approval to explore uranium. This happened in May 2019. Here, in principle approval means the concerned authority has agreed to the proposal generally and without getting into the details of other required statutory compliances or legal compliances. Also know that the Forest Advisory Committee, which is mentioned here, is a statutory body. It was formed under the Section 3 of Forest Conservation Act of 1980. Now, this in-principle approval by the central government has created huge opposition in the state of Telangana. Protests are being carried out by environmentalists, the people who live in Amrabad Mandal, and also by the political parties. And now, the news is that the Telangana State Assembly has unanimously passed a resolution requesting the central government to not to permit the mining of uranium ore, which is present in Nallamala Forest and the adjoining areas in the state of Telangana. This Nallamala Forest is spread in both Telangana and Andhra Pradesh states. The Nallamala Forest area has a rich biodiversity. It has many endangered species of flora and fauna. Most of the area is hilly terrain with plateaus, ridges, gorges, deep valleys, and they support tropical dry deciduous and moist deciduous forests. Several tribes like Chenchus and other forest dwellers are dependent on this Nallamala Forest for their livelihood. And this Nallamala Forests also serve as one of the catchment area for the Krishna River. Catchment area is the area from which rainfall flows into a river. So this means the Nallamala Forest area is rich in biodiversity. So, taking up any mining operations for uranium will damage its ecological balance. Let us see how. Uranium is a radioactive element that occurs naturally in varying but small amounts in soil, rocks, etc. It is naturally radioactive, which means that the atoms of uranium are unstable and they decay by emitting particles and energy. But if you see, this uranium itself is barely radioactive. But the ore which is mined is regarded as potentially hazardous due to uranium's decay products, especially if it is high grade ore. And the mining operations will also require deforestation of the forest lands. So once the land is exposed to radioactivity, then the chances for the plants to survive or to grow will become less. So the entire area will be a wasteland if mining is allowed, and the entire biodiversity of the forest will be affected. And we saw that Nallamala Forest also serve as a catchment area for the Krishna River. So the uranium exploration will expose and pollute the surface water, groundwater, and it will leach the minerals and dangerous chemicals into the river course. Here, leaching means a particular substance, like in this case, uranium will drain away from the soil to the water. So the entire population which is living downstream of river Krishna would be affected in the long run. And apart from this, the livelihood of the forest dwellers and the tribals including the Chenchu tribes will also be severely affected because of the uranium mining. So what is this uranium used for? Uranium is the raw material which is used to produce fuel for nuclear power plants that generate significant amounts of electricity. But we saw that the ores of uranium are radioactive. So mining for uranium leads to many health, safety and environmental risks, and these need to be managed well. Firstly, if we see, it causes risk to the workers' health and safety. So it has to be made sure that the radiation exposures of workers should be minimum, because the workers will have the long lasting impacts on health as they are directly exposed to uranium. The next, if we see the public and health safety, the nearby populations where the uranium is mined is more likely to be exposed to radioactive emissions. So the health of the nearby populations will be affected. So we can see that the exposure to uranium will cause health effects. So what kind of health effects are they likely to cause? They are likely to cause chemical toxicity and radiological toxicity in humans. The main chemical effect associated with exposure to uranium and its compounds is kidney toxicity. This toxicity can be caused by breathing air that contains uranium dusts or by eating substances that contain uranium. This uranium will enter the bloodstream. Once uranium is in the bloodstream, then the uranium compounds are filtered by the kidneys. So they will cause damage to the kidney cells. And a very high uranium levels can cause acute kidney failure and death. Next is the radiological toxicity. Radiological toxicity is the effect on humans and their body because of the radiation from the uranium. The radiation usually weakens or breaks up the DNA, which is the genetic material of the human body. So either it damages the cells in the human body or it will mutate the cell. Mutation means altering the basic structure of the cell. So finally, radiation will lead to cancer. The probability of developing a radiation-induced cancer increases with increasing exposure to uranium. So if there is uranium mining, definitely people will be exposed to uranium continuously. So they will be affected by radiation-induced cancer. This is the reason why we are telling that the livelihood of the forest dwellers and the tribals, including the Chenchus, will also be severely affected because of uranium mining. Because it will have an impact on their health and also on the forest resources that they depend on. There is one another problem with uranium mining. It is that the tailings of uranium mining must be managed properly. Here, tailings are nothing but the residues that are left after mining the ore. So this means these tailings will also be radioactive. So if they are not managed properly, and if any person is exposed to such tailing, then they are likely to have the health effects that we just now discussed. With this, we have come to the end of this article discussion. The split practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next discussion, which is based on this editorial. In this editorial, the author speaks about the prospects of Israel-Pakistan ties, then also about the India-Israel relationship and why the diplomatic ties between Israel and Pakistan will not happen now. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. In this editorial, the author says that recently there is a speculation among the Israeli and Pakistani scholars. This speculation is about the possibility of diplomatic ties between Pakistan and Israel. At present, Pakistan does not recognize the state of Israel and it has no diplomatic missions or embassies in Israel. So the author believes that this speculation is a result of a changing political dynamics of the region. It also shows Israel's growing diplomatic reach and success, especially among the Islamic countries. So first, let us understand the brief history about the formation of Israel. The present-day Israel was a part of Palestine in the Ottoman Empire till 1917. During World War I, Britain seized the territory of Palestine from Ottoman Empire in 1917. So, a Balfour Declaration was declared in 1917 by the then Foreign Secretary of Britain, Arthur Balfour. This declaration showed the support of British government to form national home for Jewish people in Palestine. The independence of the State of Israel was proclaimed in 1948 with the end of the mandate of British rule. The formation of Israel from Palestine made the Middle East politically volatile. It means the Middle East countries were not happy with the formation of Israel. This resulted in many wars among Israel and the Arab nations. After these wars, Israel was isolated by its Arab neighbors. And even today, the situation is volatile in the region. So ever since its formation, Israel is trying to overcome this isolation and it is trying to enhance the diplomatic ties with as many countries as possible. So Turkey was the first Muslim majority country to recognize Israel in 1949. Then in the year 1979, Egypt recognized Israel. Then in the year 1994, another Muslim majority country, that is Jordan, recognized Israel as a separate country. But even now, majority of the Arab countries have not recognized Israel. So the Organization of Islamic Cooperation, that is the OIC, which is known as the collective voice of the Islamic world, has criticized Israel many times for its occupation of Palestinian lands. And if you see, most recently, OIC even convened an emergency meeting to discuss a statement made by the Israel Prime Minister. The Israel Prime Minister said that if he was re-elected, he would definitely annex the Jordan Valley in the West Bank and the Northern Dead Sea. These areas now have mixed settlements of Palestinian and Jewish people. So this is the background about Israel. In this editorial, the author is discussing about the India-Israel relationship also. India established full diplomatic ties with Israel in the year 1992. It was done by opening Indian embassy in Tel Aviv, which is a city in Israel. The author says that there were many factors that brought the two democracies, that is the India and Israel, together. The most important factor is that both have successfully tackled state-centric threats. That is, they have tackled the wars led by countries throughout their history. For example, Israel have successfully dealt with confrontation with the Arab opposition many times, like during the Arab-Israel War of 1948 or in the Six-Day War in the year 1967 or during the Yom Kippur War or Ramadan War in the year 1973. Like this, India has also successfully tackled several hostilities or opposition from Pakistan since partition. Another factor is that both Israel and India are victims of asymmetric warfare, such as terrorism, till this date. Here, asymmetric warfare is war between opposing forces which differ greatly in military power, and it involves the use of unconventional weapons and tactics such as guerrilla warfare and terrorist attacks. So these are the factors which brought these two democracies together. Then the author also says that the dynamism in India's foreign policy helped India to improve its interactions with the countries of the Gulf Cooperation Council. This means we were able to cooperate with two adversaries or between two rivals, that is Israel and the Arab nations, because we saw that Arab nations have showed historical enmity with Israel. So India was able to cooperate with these adversaries without compromising our own interests. Even though Israel was isolated within the Islamic world, Israel was successful in expanding its diplomatic relationship beyond its neighborhood. Author is saying that because Israel has established diplomatic relations with 162 countries, which means Israel has a diplomatic relation with a majority of the 193 UN member states. And the author believes that the Indo-Pacific region is emerging as the prime focus of Israel. Then if you talk about Israel-China relationship, China and Israel established a diplomatic relationship in the year 1992. But their relationship is limited to the economic sphere because they are maintaining their relationship with respect to trade, investment, education exchanges and tourism between the two countries. But if you see, Israel is a leading sophisticated arms seller in the world. But Israel does not sell its arms to China. This is because of USA. Because USA is an all-weather ally of Israel. When we say all-weather ally, it means someone who will stay with us whatever may be the situation. So the author is calling USA as an all-weather ally of Israel. And USA has embargoed or banned arms deal with China. So that is why Israel is not selling arms to China, and Israel has limited its relationship with China to the economic sphere only. But however, Israel was able to expand its arms sales to India and countries in the Southeast Asia such as Vietnam, Myanmar, Philippines, etc. Then the author is saying that Israel is also looking to increase its diplomatic relations in South Asia and beyond. This is because if Israel can make closer ties with Muslim populous countries in Asia, such as it can maintain a diplomatic relation with Bangladesh, Indonesia and Pakistan, then its legitimacy in the Islamic world will increase. So now based on this, let us discuss the prospects of Israel-Pakistan. As we saw in the beginning, some scholars believe that there is a possibility of diplomatic ties between Pakistan and Israel. And some even believe that Pakistan's national interest would be served better if Pakistan establishes ties with Israel. They believe that the close ties between Israel and the US can be used to alleviate or reduce the repeated tensions between US and Pakistan. Then one another reason they are saying this because they have almost the same concern with respect to Iran. So what is Pakistan's concern with respect to Iran? It is that Pakistan virtually supports the Sunni terrorist organization of Taliban. which was always a threat to the Shia majority in Iran. And Pakistan is also an ally of Saudi Arabia, and Saudi Arabia is the biggest adversary or rival of Iran. Then if you see with respect to Israel, Israel often accuses Iran of sponsoring the Hezbollah, which attacks Israel from the West Bank. It is said that Iran helped to create the terrorist group Hezbollah in Lebanon in the early 1980s in order to expand its influence in the region. And Israel is against this. So as we say, enemy of our enemy is our friend. Like that, Israel is enemy of Iran and Pakistan is also an enemy of Iran. So some believe that Israel and Pakistan can maintain diplomatic relationships because they have common enmity with Iran. But if you see, the author believes that a rapprochement between Israel and Pakistan is unlikely. Rapprochement means establishing harmonious relations. So establishing harmonious relation between Israel and Pakistan is very unlikely according to the author. The first reason for this which the author gives is that Pakistan and the Sunni Arab countries have close relationships, and these Arab countries are against Israel. And Pakistan has also deployed its military units in countries such as Saudi Arabia and Jordan to promote internal stability and for training their military, etc. And the Arab countries have rescued Pakistan many times during its financial crisis. So, the author is saying Pakistan would not compromise its relations with the Muslim countries for Israel. Then another reason is OIC, that is Organization of Islamic Countries. This platform was used by Pakistan to raise the Kashmir issue, and Pakistan accused India as the perpetrator. And the same platform, that is Organization of Islamic Countries, was used to criticize Israel also. They criticized Israel for using its forces and military on Palestinian people. That means Israel was accused of oppressing the Palestinian people in a similar way India was accused for oppressing Kashmiris, as claimed by Pakistan. So the author is saying that establishing diplomatic ties with Israel might weaken the support for the Pakistan within OIC. So this means it will especially affect the Pakistan side on the Kashmir issue. Along with this, Pakistan has a large number of influential conservative Islamic groups. So they will also oppose the move of Israel-Pakistan ties because they still see Israel as an intruder in Palestine. Even recently, the military spokesperson of Pakistan refuted or denied the possibility of Pakistan's recognition of Israel as a state. He even called it as a propaganda war to turn the Pakistani people against the military. So the author is saying that though Pakistan has differing opinion with Iran, it might not fight Iran for maintaining ties with Israel. Because if it fights with Iran, then such a move will escalate the sectarian conflict, that is the Sunni Shia conflict in Pakistan, because 20% of Pakistan's population are Shia Muslims. And the author also gives one another example to show that Pakistan will not go against Iran. Author is saying that in the year 2015, Pakistan turned down a request by Saudi Arabia to join military intervention in Yemen. And this intervention was to fight the rebels who were supported by Iran. But Pakistan did not join it. So this shows that Pakistan will not go against Iran. So finally, the author is saying that India was able to maintain a successful relationship between Israel and Palestine. So Israel may hope to do so between India and Pakistan. But the author feels that Israel might not want to have diplomatic ties with Pakistan, because Pakistan is considered as a state that sponsors terrorism. So the author concludes by saying that maintaining diplomatic relations is a sovereign right of a state or a country. But the idea of diplomatic ties between Israel and Pakistan remains a pie in the sky, which means it is an unlikely idea for the time being. With this, we have come to the end of this article discussion. This news article is about the steps taken by the Union government to revive the export sector. The discussion can be linked with the syllabus that is given here for your reference. The news article states that the Commerce Minister has launched a common digital platform for the issuance of certificates of origin. And he has also launched a platform for the steel import monitoring system. The minister also gave more details about the enhanced export credit insurance scheme for banks that lent working capital to exporters. This is in continuation with the recent announcement by the finance minister to revive the export sector. So first, let us discuss about the Steel Import Monitoring System, or in short, SIMS. SIMS will provide advance information about steel import to government and other stakeholders, such as it will give information to the producers and to the consumers also. This will help to frame effective policy interventions. In this system, the importers of specified steel products will have to register in advance on the web portal of SIMS by providing necessary information. The Commerce Minister has noted that the registration will be online and automatic, and no human intervention will be required. The information about the steel imports, which is provided by the importers on SIMS, will be monitored by the Ministry of Steel. With respect to SIMS, the Commerce Minister has said that SIMS will not act as a licensing system, which means it will not stop anyone from importing steel. Rather, it is just a tool to capture information about steel imports. This will help to gather information such as the grades of imported steel, the domestic market potential of steel, and from where it is imported, etc. So, this is with respect to SIMS. Now, let us discuss about the launch of Common Digital Platform for the issuance of electronic certificates of origin. Certificate of origin is a document which declares the detail of in which country the commodity or good was manufactured. The exporters have to show the certificates that the consignment has originated from India for the exports to countries which are having free trade agreements or preferential trade agreements with India. Only then they will be able to avail benefits such as reduced import tariffs. So, the certificate of origin is used to verify that the export products are produced in India. At present, it is issued manually by various agencies according to the rules of origin criteria, which is based on the respective free trade agreements and preferential trade agreements. But now, the Common Digital Platform has been launched. So, from now on, these certificates can be obtained online. All the issuing authorities will be on the same portal, and this portal is aimed to ease the regulatory burden on exports from India. The article also says that India is speaking to its trading partners and the countries with which it has FTAs, that is free trade agreements. This is to ensure that they accept digital certificates. So, this is with respect to the Common Digital Platform. Now, let us discuss about the new Export Credit Insurance Scheme. This new Export Credit Insurance Scheme will be called NIRVIC. NIRVIC scheme was introduced by the Export Credit Guarantee Corporation, which in short is known as ECGC. This scheme is aimed to ease the lending process and to enhance loan availability for exporters. Now, also know that the ECGC was established in the year 1957. It was established to provide export credit insurance support to Indian exporters. The ECGC works under the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. It provides the export credit insurance to protect the banks, which provides export for exporters. This insurance by ECGC will protect the banks from losses. These are the losses that occur due to risks of insolvency or default by the borrower. Now, here insolvency is a situation in which an individual or organization cannot pay their bills and debts. So, this insurance will cover this risk of insolvency. If you see, at present, the ECGC covers 60% of the loss to the banks. Now, this new scheme will cover 90% of the principal and also of the interests. And half of these amount will be provided in 30 days. The scheme also mandates inspection of bank documents and records by ECGC officials. This inspection is for losses that is exceeding rupees 10 crore. At present, the limit for inspection is rupees 1 crore. The minister also said that the existing premium rates will be lowered. Also, the loans given by the banks would be categorized into two broad categories. One is for the loans below 80 crore rupees and the other is for above 80 crore rupees. And this loans above 80 crore rupees will be further divided into two. One is the loans which are for gold, jewelry and diamonds. And the second is for the loans which are not for gold, jewelry and diamonds. So, the banks will benefit from this enhanced credit coverage. The article also says that the rating for bank loans to exporters will become AA rating. It is because of the enhanced insurance cover. See, normally rating organizations evaluate the credit worthiness of an issuer with respect to the debt instruments or its general ability to pay back debt over a specified period of time. And the instruments with AA rating are considered to have high degree of safety regarding timely servicing of financial obligations. This means the debt will be paid back at the appropriate time. So, we can say that the instruments with AA rating carry very low credit risk. So, this means the credit given will not be lost and the banks will be on the safer side. With this, we have come to the end of this article discussion. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. We have come to the final session for the day, which is the practice questions discussion session. In this question, two statements have been given and we have to choose the correct statement. First statement states, legislations with respect to preventive detention for reasons connected with the security of a state and the maintenance of public order comes under the union list of the constitution. Now, during discussion, we saw that preventive detention is mentioned in union list and also in concurrent list, but in two different categories. The one which deals with the union list states that preventive detention for reasons connected with defense, foreign affairs or the security of India and the persons who are subjected to detention because of these reasons. So, only these conditions comes under union list. So, this means this statement is wrong because it talks about the security of a state and the maintenance of public order. This comes under the concurrent list and not the union list. So, this statement is wrong. If you see the second statement, you can divide this statement into two parts. In this list one, we know that it means the union list and it comes under the seventh schedule. So, this part is correct and we know that union list consists of the subjects in which the parliament has exclusive power to make laws. So, this part is correct. But now we have to know whether this comes under Article 246 Clause 1 or not. If you see, the 7th schedule is totally based on Article 246 only. It provides for three lists. One is List 1, that is Union List, and the second is List 2, which is State List, and the third is List 3, which is Concurrent List. And among this, Clause 1 talks about the Union List. So, this means this statement is correct. And also remember that Article 246 Clause 2 talks about the concurrent list. It states that along with Parliament, the legislature of any state also has the power to make laws with respect to any of the matters enumerated in List 3 in the 7th schedule. So, List 3 is the concurrent list. We know that. So, don't confuse. Clause 1 is about union list. Clause 2 is about concurrent list. And Clause 3 is about state list. The question asks for the correct statements. Here, statement 2 is the correct statement. So, the final correct answer to this question is option B, 2 only. If you look at this next question, it asks which of the following pollutants are emitted on combustion of coal. Four pollutants have been given: sulfur dioxide, carbon dioxide, fly ash, mercury. During discussion, we saw that the combustion of coal releases many pollutants and among them were sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxides, particulate matter, carbon dioxide, fly ash, mercury and certain other heavy metals. So, this means all the pollutants which are given here are emitted by the combustion of coal. So, here the correct answer to this question is option C, all the above. In this next question, pairs have been given. One is with respect to tiger reserves and the other is state. So, we have to choose the incorrect pairs. Today's discussion was based on Amrabad and Nagarjuna Sagar Sri Sailam Tiger Reserves. And we saw the discussion based on a resolution made by the Telangana state government. So, from the discussion, you can say that Amrabad is in Telangana, not in Chhattisgarh. So, this means this is a incorrect pair. Now, the second pair says Nagarjuna Sagar Sri Sailam is in Telangana state. Now, before bifurcation of the Andhra Pradesh state, Amrabad was one of the Nagarjuna Sagar Sri Sailam Tiger Reserve. But after the bifurcation, it was carved out of Nagarjuna Sagar, Sri Sailam. So you can say by this lines that Amrabad is in Telangana and it has been carved out. That means Nagarjuna Sagar, Sri Sailam is still in Andhra Pradesh. So remember this tactic. As Telangana was carved out of Andhra Pradesh, Amrabad was also carved out. So in this, these two are incorrect. And the third pair is given as Bandipur, Karnataka. Now this pair is correct. Bandipur Tiger Reserve is located in the state of Karnataka. Now while answering this question, you have to be very careful. Because in a hurry, you should not mark option C 3 only. Because here the third pair is the correct pair. But the question asks for the incorrect pairs. Here 1 and 2 are the incorrect pair. So the correct answer to this question is option B 1 and 2 only. Now in this question, two statements are given. We have to choose the correct statement. First statement is with respect to Nirvik scheme. It states the scheme is aimed to ease the lending process and enhance loan availability for exporters. Now this statement is correct. This scheme was introduced by the Export Credit Guarantee Corporation. Now the second statement states the Export Credit Guarantee Corporation works under Ministry of Commerce and Industry. Now this statement is also correct. This corporation works under Ministry of Commerce and Industry and it provides the export credit insurance to protect the banks which provides export credit for exporters. So in this both the statements are correct and the question also asks for the correct statement. So the final correct answer to this question is option C, both 1 and 2.